right, so all these kind of build on top of each other. I'm going to try and go as quickly through these as possible so that you get a chance to play with the tool with your own hands as much as possible, okay? So this presentation covers the landscape of publishing tools that exist out there. A little bit of the past and the present, but more focus on the present. So, can everybody see this diagram? It's kind of our publishing workflow. So, we're starting with what type of data at the very top. That's what that says, which type of data? We've got metadata, taxonomic data, and occurrence data. Now the next step is to select a tool, okay? That's what this one says here. And so we've got BITC, the spreadsheet processor, and some other tools, such as Digger, Tapio, and Biodiversity. The next in the workflow is called publish your data. Okay, that's what this one here says. This is sharing your data with the world. The next step is called registering with Jupyter. That's putting your data into a global registry so that everybody in the world can discover your data set and what it's about. And the very last part in this workflow, down here, is called discovery through the portal. Discovery through the GDIF data portal. So this is where people can search through your data, download your data, and use it in their modeling, statistical analysis. Okay. So you're going to be seeing this quite a lot. And the important thing to remember is this is just the workflow. This is kind of guiding you through the different steps to publishing, one at the next, with the ultimate goal of putting your data set online, where it's freely available over the internet, and people can come and find it, either in the registry or in the data portal. Okay? So there's recommended tools depending on who you are. Now, if you're just a single person, a single researcher, and you've got just one resource, it's probably easiest for you, especially if you're using Microsoft Excel, to just keep using Microsoft Excel. And it would be recommendable to use the spreadsheet templates like we saw earlier. Now, if you're a larger institution, and you've got several different departments, and you've got several different resources within each department that you'd like to publish, it's recommended that you use the IPT, where different researchers can log in and they can configure their data sets and publish them. Now, again, all these tools. Well, the spreadsheet template and the IPT, they're designed to help you publish your metadata, your primary biodiversity data, and your taxonomic data. But before we get into the present tools, let's take a look back at the past, okay? Let's take a look at these so-called wrapper tools. Digger, Tapio, and Biobanks. I know there's at least one person in the room that has heard of Biobanks, the gentleman from Congo. Is that right? Yes. That's correct. So you've heard of Biobanks? Yes?
Yes.
So, let me explain a little bit about how these past tools, these wrapper tools, work. So let's take Tapio as an example, all right? So you've got a database. You've got Tanyo that exposes your database. And somebody out there, such as Jiva, can come and harvest your information. And they can ask for pages of information using the standard Tanyo protocol. Now, imagine that you had 260,000 records. And you were able to exchange 1,000 records with every request. It would take more than 260 that exchange. So me coming to your server asking, give me 1,000 records. Okay, I've got that. Now give me another. And you have to go through that process 260 times to be able to recover, to harvest all of those records. So it's quite tedious for a central indexer like Jika to go and do that. Right? The end result of 260 data exchanges is about 500 megabytes of information. Now take your, it's basically giving back responses in XML language, which is quite verbose, and there's a lot of information wrapped inside these elements. The whole process takes about 9 hours to finish. And you know, when you take all the extra information out of it and you store it in the tabular form with no XML, it becomes quite small. Actually, it's only about 32 megabytes of information. So can all of you believe that storing that same information in a DAW or archive into the test format becomes 3 megabytes? So it's a huge savings, a huge savings. Here were some of the limitations to these older wrapper tools. So they weren't really able to handle checklists, taxonomic data. There was no use of a standard for metadata. There was no automatic registration with GDPR. The schemas were either very simple, or they were way too complex. And as I demonstrated in the last slide, the data sharing, being able to harvest the information is not very efficient, especially in large numbers of records. And there's no ability to upload the data either. So these were some of the limitations with the old tools. Why a lot of development is focused on new tools to make it easier to publish your data. So, coming back to the DAW and Core Archive example, imagine you have a DAW and Core Archive with 260,000 records. It's the same data set, but now instead of publishing it through the Tanyo tool, you've decided to publish it through another tool using a DAW and Core Archive. How many times does it take me to come to your server and say, give me your whole data set? It takes one time, right? Because everything is inside one folder, and it's just as simple as downloading any folder off the internet. It's that simple. Just come, make a request. One request. Now, it wasn't 500 megabytes. All that content actually got compressed down to 3 megabytes. So that single request that I make, it actually goes quite fast. And depending on your connection speed, it could take a couple seconds. So, what kind of a speed up does that offer us? Well, by my calculation, it's more than a 16,000 time improvement in speed. That's pretty fast. And that's the reason why DAW and Core Archives are becoming so widely available and so widely accepted. People love this. They're the easiest way to share the biodiversity information with everything wrapped up inside. So again, what are the tools that you can use to share DAW and Core Archives? Well, you've got the IPT, and spreadsheet processes, which we're concentrating a lot on this week. And here's my favorite, the IPT. Now, is it any surprise to you, after all these slides, that the IPT is a single platform allowing the sharing of our primary biodiversity data, our taxonomic data, and our metadata? Shouldn't be this way. That's what the IPT does. What are some of its key features? Well, there's no cost associated with this software. It's completely free and open for anybody in the world to use, to download, to install, and even if they had the technical capacity to make contributions back to the IPT software. Now, the IPT doesn't take very much to develop. In fact, there are minimal server requirements. And I know everybody in this room has a more powerful laptop than what is required to be able to host an IPT. It'll actually run on 256 megabytes of memory, which is not very much. I think most people in the room have at least 2 gigabytes of RAM on their machine, right? Okay. And there's no internal database either. So all that leads to very good performance. And to give you an example, the IPT can publish 24 million records in 50 minutes, connecting it to a MySQL database that wasn't even on the same machine, it's in the same network, using that little amount of memory. Isn't that unbelievable? So this is a very powerful tool. It doesn't matter if you have 500 records or if you have 24 million records, which maybe some of you will someday, but it's very fast. So here are some of its general features. When I went around with each of you, like creating an account, I demonstrated the user management features available for administrators. And I created a managerial account for each of you with registration rights. So there's administrator users, there's managers, and then general users. So there's very comprehensive user management in the IPT. There's institution management, which basically allows people to automatically discover their own institution and load it in. And I'll be showing that a little bit later. There's extension management, so all these ways to extend your data using extensions. You can discover those as well from the GBIF registry and load those in and update those in your IPT. And the way that it shares the information, the way that it publishes using the DOM archive and the GBIF metadata profile based on the email, they're very simple and efficient standards. So when it comes to configuring your data set, okay? So you come to this tool, what does it allow you to do? Well, it allows you to author your metadata. So just like a spreadsheet template on the very first sheet, you can enter in all your data set metadata there. Now, some of you have your existing data in an Excel spreadsheet. Maybe you just have it in a text file. Maybe it's inside a database. But the IPT allows you to upload your information from those different sources directly into the tool. You can even upload a downloadable archive, such as the one you created in the spreadsheet template. And maybe we can do a quick demonstration that way. Here's a great thing. It allows you to map to downloadable terms inside the tool. So remember that exercise that we did with John on the first day, where we had that list of different terms up there and we had to figure out, okay, well, that probably means event date. Remember that mapping? Well, that feature is built right into the tool, so you can do that your data is inside the tool, you don't make it public until you say, I want to make it public. Until you explicitly say, hit the public button. I want to share this with the world. Until then, your data remains.